So what I'm going to present you today is running code, actually, that you can download. In the end, there will be a link on these slide stacks here from the Material Digital DE website if you are registered there for an account. It's in the download section, should be available today. And why do we present running code? Because everything we talked about today is a little bit well abstract, of course. So now with Marcus's presentation just right now, we delved into the domain of tools. And at the very end, you saw this website GUI that is the Onto Docker. And in the code that you can download here, it's rather small. It's like about 30 megabytes, but it will inflate because it will create a Docker setup on your system that basically shows a specific example of an application ontology that is representing heat treatments that we derived from practical workflows at the IWT. So these are huge machines that are literally furnaces working all day long. And so they're continuously creating data. And this is what this is about, because this presentation will start with three relatively dry text-laden slides, giving you some context, and then delves into the really interesting parts, explaining more about how this data flow from the machine into your ontology can look like. And that's a little bit of an expectation management I want to start with. This can is just a proposal. This is the carnage of sausage making here. So while we have a 0.1 version of ontologies, we are close to that. But maybe start with the next slide, please. And so we, this is about the, again, getting the data. It is also about automation a little bit. So the tools we provide here can, if you choose to look into the actual running code, and it's all the Python code effectively, so it's actually scripts when you really look at it hard. But typically people say this is code, and it's used to start with a certain representation. We'll come to that later. It's about multiple components that will address certain tasks in your institute, research facility, manufacturer site, whatever you have, where data, the primary data you start with, comes from. All these data origins are very, let's call them heterogeneous. Yeah. So sometimes it's machine readable, sometimes it's human readable, sometimes it's very proprietary, and you can't even get to it, which then you can really solve only by asking your vendor very, very politely to have some more insight into that. So all these chains that you have in manufacturing, you are effectively recreating a little bit when you start to manufacture your own ontology data, which is a commodity. So please treat this as a value add that you can create inside your research facility or your manufacturer site. But when you start integrating stuff into reality, you encounter policies. That's something most people have at their research. Sometimes it's confidential information. Sometimes it's just about data privacy, and typically it's just called information security. And in these solutions out there, they typically create network topologies that are decoupled. So now one piece of thing in your manufacturer hall cannot talk to the cloud directly. And again, chains emerge, policies are basically the holes between the barriers that were erected to protect you and your data. And the solutions you want to integrate here to fuel ontologies in the end, well, they have to take them into account. So if you want to have this data flow from your furnace, again, coming back to the heat treatment, to your ontology graph database, there are some tasks to do here. So what we have is early access, literally. So we don't even version this. This is a demonstrator with a revision. And yes, if you think that might be useful to you, it's at least an idea how you could do it to give you something more than a slide deck, effectively. And yeah, we will open up that insight and also show a case a little bit how we deal with the heterogeneity of data. Next slide, please. Also, it shows a little bit that you have to make decisions. These decisions are about customization. So when you have a solution, for example, for the heat treatment here, there's an original data origin that we work with. I will come to this later again. You have to customize your tools. So this tool here is already pre-customized to a certain example. And this customization is domain specific to the reality, how our heat treatment data looks like on site. If you want to adapt this tool set or the idea behind it, or maybe even not do that, that is due to the fact that you hopefully, and I would strongly recommend it, take into account your real life processes, how you got the data today. And this would simplify the creation of components and the customization of components by creating these patterns. Because when you detect a pattern of the data between a tensile test and a heat treatment test data, and then your domain-specific data, these patterns will feed back into the work we're doing here at Material Digital. So learning these patterns is, of course, interesting. And there's a very obvious pattern here that I provided as an example, process steps, and that processes that are based on classes and have basically could be composed of a subordinate process. So like a heat treatment could be something that is heating something up. Or it could a process step that's soaking, so it's keeping the temperature, and it really makes the microstructure work right now. And then later on, you're probably just cooling it to room temperature passively, or quench it in some hot or cold oil. And so these are subordinate processes that then make up your individual domain. And again, my example here is coming from heat treatment. And so these processes and subordinate processes structures, that's something we already generalized, and that's provided in the core ontology as already highlighted. And then you will have your own specific things that has to be covered. So these are specialization from the core that will go into your application ontology. So that's the now this is kind of like tentatively going into the direction of how to model stuff, but that's just a very tiny piece for a bigger picture that I'm presenting here right now. When we're talking about acquisition, customization, and this data flows, then things break a lot. Sometimes your automated process does not aggregate anything anymore. So I'm again coming with two examples here. And one of the examples is that somehow the thing you're fueling into, in this case, it's the ontology or the graph database you want to instantiate named individuals in, changes. And changes in a way that is not only adding something that you're not aware of, so that's probably not very helpful, but changing something that you wrote into yesterday but is named the same way today. These are painful changes. They will happen at some point when we work all together here and try to create synergy. But we want to orchestrate this pain via a well-defined curation process. This will come up in the following months. And also, on the other hand, you basically have a machine, a firmware update, and suddenly the field foo is now called bar, and it doesn't work anymore. So this typically, from the point of view of the data aggregation unit, comes very suddenly and from out of the blue. So these are only two examples that we will have to live with during our process to projects here. And just as a small heads up. So next slide, please. Yeah, that's very obvious on my first line. Coming back to heat treatment, we followed some design principles here. You maybe know this bottom-up design where you start with the raw data that you have. That's not always the smartest way to do. That is, you can yield results relatively fast, but then you might come up with rearranging the terms you came up with over and over again because you did not think about what you want to map to. So there is a bottom-up design for terminology, which is fine because I think you have to get your glossary in order, and that can be very detailed. Again, there are other methods here, and we will get into these specifics later in the following months, of course, with the expertise of the FITS, and Isaac, of course, also. But there are, for example, things that we already give you. And that is, again, the core ontology. So if you design something from the bottom up, you can also keep the top in mind, and that's the outside-in design. So this heat treatment here is not based on something like a ISO standard and very top-down driven. It really started with the things we had in hand, and therefore it shows. It is not as curated as the tensile test ontology. It grew fast and it was changed a lot. So that, of course, is stressful to any kind of pure creation process that we want to provide. So again, keep that in mind. So we learned some lessons here because we had to stress test our own approaches to some extent. So again, this is all work in progress. We call it a review 2 release because the last month we were working at revision 02 release because the last month we were working at the revision 01, which really was not running at all. It was just a loose set of scripts. Now it's composed into something we can showcase. And we almost are using the actual 0.1 version of the core ontology that is available via the Material Digital site today. Unfortunately, I think there are two items in our two data properties in our ontology that we use here that are not used, that was stripped from the final version. So again, so close, but almost. And so this is a feeling you will always have, I think, probably will always have, but that is not a bad thing. It comes with the territory. And that is what, as Markus Niebel was always willing, be patient with us, with yourself, and how the synergy grows and works. So now, all these dry slides aside, now we come to the actual meat of the thing. So next slide, please. We have heat treatment illustrated by this cool steel sheet manufacturer mill here. We get data from there. We use a task, it's called wrapping. That's not the best nomer in the world. So maybe it's just a collecting a task, but that's what we are going with now. So we get the original data, we wrap it into something. Basically what we do is we create a new unified intermediate format from that. And now the mapper that is also typically domain specific in this case, it knows all the words and terms from the identifiers in the heat treatment domain, can store them into a triple store. We are using BlazeGraph apparently here. And when that is done on the bottom right side, machines or humans can use the graphical user interface or APIs to get information from the graph database. So that's a very simple data flow. We have three tasks here, but now let's look under the hood a little bit. Next slide. What we get from our heat treatment furnace is a CSV. That is not surprising at all. How we get that though, via that's what the human gets. So there's an graphical user interface. Again, you can browse that and you can download CSVs from that actual furnace. It has a little computer box basically as a component of it. But when you want to do this automatically, we have an SPS-like system. It's from the 80s. It's rather nostalgic to implement that, and then you get S5 protocol derived bytes wise little endian data, which is like the worst, so to speak. And then you have to reassemble all this. So this example that we provide you here with, of course, is actually a real world example. It's derived from an actual heat treatment furnace. And it is a CSV. But again, you can have a lot of things, and these wrapper take care of that because they put all this heterogeneous data into a unified intermediate format. Next slide, please. Which is, as MongoDB, some people might be familiar with the term, already spoiled the surprise, is in JSON format. So the JSON format, there's an intermediate thing that we defined for how to express data series in the tensile test over time and according metadata. And of course, a data series over time, how temperatures evolve accomplished, whatever you want to say, call this, in a heat treatment furnace. So these two things can be look quite similar. Tensile tests and heat treatments develop over time, and they create a data series. So we have some JSON format there that we can will and can share with you, of course. And next slide, please. This is then mapped via a specific another tool that is has a task of then creating the actual triples for the graph database, converted into a turtle file. You can upload into your graph database, and that turtle file adheres now to the terminology that was created in previous steps. So when you look at the data and define your glossary and define your terms, this is now reusing that. And when this is all instantiated, actually, in the triple store, you end up with asking is the queries, basically, requesting a specific set of results. And next slide, please. And that was already shown by Marco Schilling, I think, with the OntoDocker tool, which comes in a very, again, sausage work in process version. With this demonstrator here, it will also instantiate on localhost this graphical interface you just saw. That's a little bit differently popularized, of course, because it's just heat treatment data in there then. But you can start your own queries, actually. And that's basically the last slide here on this set, because, yeah. I think that is a little less interactive than what Marco Schilling just showed. So this is basically the whole data flow that is done or is conducted by the showcase tool set we call the Onto pipe, because these three data flow segments we now concatenate, and that's basically a data pipe. So they're very, very intuitive. And unfortunately, when you name things, once the names stick, the showcase is called Onto pipe. Yeah, there's that. So last slide, maybe one next to last slide is an actual architecture here. So there are components that include these tasks. These components are a part of the demonstrator you can download. There's only one kind of data origin supported here, which is the CSV, but there are three examples coming with the demonstrator. The tools interact, the data exchange is really, really simple. It's just files moving via volumes that are shared between multiple Dockers. So these blue arrows between the Onto collector, the Onto aggregator, and the actual Onto app with the GUI you already saw, they are Docker volumes, and it's very, very simple, down to earth. There's a README that's really, really readable, actually, and it's kept very simple. So not to overwhelm people who are very, very new to this with all the complicated things you want to install, we tried to streamline that a little bit. So when we do this in practice in the following months and years, there will be a PMD satellite service as a system, so server, what you want to call it, be available to instantiate. Then we will also have, like here you can see it already, a keycloak authentication, which is a single sign-on mechanism to make this available. It will be a part of a bigger thing. The platform will provide a lot of stuff, but this is the ontology meeting and the ontology workshop for onboarding, and so that's the focus here. And as a final slide, there will be two links. It's hard to copy them from a presentation slide right now, but there is the actual online HackMD right now. It's not write protected. You can mess with that. Leave your mark there if you like. Leave a question. That's okay. We copied that. So we can restore older versions, of course, but that's an online editable and a modifiable document right now where you can add findings or questions or something like that as a very first point of contact without using email right now. And then if you are already familiar with it, and I'm relatively sure you are, the Material Digital DE domain here, the website, has a download section that now includes a category that is called PMD Demonstrator, where you can download this. It should be with the README, and so we hope, but we are a little bit coming from the computing science side, relatively self-explanatory if you're used Linux systems. You saw a Docker once in your lifetime. You know a little bit of Python scripting. You know how bash scripts work and how to hack CLI commands into your shell. If you're on that level, you might find your way around that demonstrator. So maybe get some help on your side if you are not super familiar with all these environments required. The README gives you an indication what to expect here, and then try to unpack the archive and test that. So that is our takeaway present, so to speak. That's not actually a present, the tangible thing for you today. And just as to show there is running code, and getting something into your hands actually had to, we had to fillet some of the pieces out of here, out of the big thing that we are building right now. So I hope it is to your liking. And first feedback, actually we plan to do via the HackMD. So again, we have a big discussion round later, but also, of course, we could have questions now.